everyone. Welcome to worship. Few brief announcements. We have a lot of things going on in the worship service today, but you will notice in the bulletin, if you will pick one up in the back, that there is a dove. This is because at 11 o'clock service today, we're bringing in two new members, Michael and Rachel Boyd, and their children, Emma and Connor. And then Connor will be baptized as well at 11. And you may use this dove to write scripture, prayers of blessing, any message of love and encouragement to Connor and his family. And then the children will be collecting these as we leave the sanctuary this morning. And then you'll notice there's a rosebud on the communion table. That's in celebration of the birth that I announced last week. Sela Mae Bossy, daughter of Tim and Sarah Bossy, and granddaughter of Ramona and Tim Bossy. So we celebrate with that family in the weeks ahead. And as we have been announcing, the rummage sale is next weekend, so there are details in the bulletin about bringing donations in and about the hours for the sale itself. And then next Sunday is Pentecost Sunday, the day that we celebrate the birth of the church, and traditionally here at Beulah, we wear red. Red is the color of the celebration of the coming of the Spirit. So let's invite the Spirit now as we stand and worship Him.
Would you please stand? It is not our circumstances that provoke us to worship God, but it is in the circumstances that we can find God and understand God and learn to love God. This next song we're going to sing this morning is kind of dated in melody, but the text is so rich, and it's full of money. It's so rich in kind of helping us to understand how to fulfill the commission of spreading Christ's love into the world to each other this morning, and with all the areas of injustice in our world and the suffering and the whole earth, we just join together our voices for that now and offer up our praises to God.
May our homes be filled with dancing. May our streets be filled with joy. May injustice bow to Jesus as the people turn and pray.
God, you know how much we need you. But do we know how much we need you? Let us come before God at a time of confession, bow our heads and pray. Gracious and loving God, we sin without giving it a second thought. We confess faith, yet we live as practical atheists. We are indifferent to your word. We are deaf to your spirit. We condone evil not only in ourselves, but in others. Often, we do not think of you at all. Not in our choices, not in our words, not in our actions. We have exchanged your truth for a lie, and we worship idols of our own making. Forgive us, Father, and make us clean. Renew us so that we may hear and obey your call on our lives. Help us to live in your grace and for your glory. We pray all this through Jesus Christ. Amen. Friends, we come before God dirty with our sin, but remember, we are cleansed by the blood of God. Hear these words of the assurance of pardon. And these things we write so that our joy may be made complete. And this is the message we have heard from him, and we announce to you, that God is light. And in him, there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him, and yet walk in the darkness, we lie, and we do not practice the truth. But if we talk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Thanks be to God.
The scripture today is from John chapter 6. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountains and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "6 month wages would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to see, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. This is the word of the Lord. When I was in college, I was able to take a month-long trip to England with a group of students and professors. And one weekend, a smaller number of us went to Paris. And I was really looking forward to this, especially to go to the Louvre. I wanted to see the Mona Lisa. Well, we got there, and the line was long to see the Mona Lisa. And what they did is they had us walk slowly along this roped area that was really quite far back from the painting. And by the time you got up there, you had to keep walking. You probably had 30 to 40 seconds to look at the painting from a distance. So I was very disappointed that I didn't get to just stand there and look at it, which is what I like to do with paintings. But all that disappointment was wiped away with the magnificent art that I got to see, like Michelangelo's David, 17 feet tall. It was amazing, a great trip. But This is about expectations. And expectations have a lot to do with our ability to enjoy life and our ability to delight in God's good gifts to us. Expectations can blind us from reality. They can keep us from seeing the truth. Expectations can make us angry and disappointed when we don't get what we want. Expectations have a lot to do with this story in John chapter 6 today. In fact, there are layers of expectations here to understand. But first of all, we need to understand our own expectations when we come to this scripture, because many of us have heard these stories many, many times. And so we may think as we come to these stories today that we don't have anything new to learn from them. In fact, if this is your expectation, I imagine you've already tuned out and you're thinking about something else. But it may also be that you have an expectation about what these stories mean. Because you've heard sermons before or you've read books, you have an idea kind of fixed in your mind what I'm going to say today. But the truth is, whenever we come to Scripture, any Scripture, we need to be open. Open minds, open hearts, because the thing that God may give us may very well be something unexpected. So we have to be aware of our own expectations when we come to this passage this morning. And then secondly, we have the expectations of the people in the stories, the disciples and the people who had gathered to listen to Jesus. And over and against all these expectations is Jesus, the unexpected Jesus doing the unexpected things. Jesus didn't try to live up to people's expectations. So let's look first at the disciples. Now, clearly, Jesus took them by surprise when he suggested that all these people should be fed. Philip said to him, "Where are we to buy bread for these?" Jesus said to him, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" And Philip said, 6 months' wages would not buy enough bread for them to even get a little." And then Andrew spoke up and he said, "Well, here's a boy, he has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish." But then he kind of caught himself and he took back the suggestion. But what are they among so many people? So Philip didn't expect that anyone, even Jesus, would be able to feed all the people. And Andrew wasn't sure. So Jesus did the unexpected. He had the people sit down, and he took the food, and he thanked God for it. And then the loaves and the fish were distributed, and the people had more than enough to eat. When the disciples gathered up the leftovers, there were 12 baskets. Now, some people believe that the miracle in this story is that Jesus inspired each person to share the food that they had brought for themselves. In other words, the miracle of the story would be one of inspiration and not multiplication. But yet, this interpretation doesn't really fit with what we've seen in the Gospel of John so far. Remember, John wrote his gospel in large part to show the deity of Christ. And in these two stories here, John very clearly wants us to see that this is the Jesus of miracles. The story of the feeding of the 5,000 is the only miracle story that is told in all 4 Gospels. That means it's significant. Each Gospel writer wrote it down, and each one recognized that this miracle was a sign to the people. And the people understood at this point who Jesus is. They recognized him. They said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." So Jesus had convinced them, so much so that they wanted to forcibly take him and make him king. Now that had to do with their expectations about the Jewish Messiah. When the people said, "This is indeed the prophet," they were referring to the hope that someone like the great prophet Elijah in their history would come and bring the fulfillment of all of God's promises to his people. Another aspect of this hope had to do with King David. David's reign in Israel was the golden era, and the Jewish people hoped that the Messiah would usher in a time like that great day of glory with King David. Now, Jesus, at this point, understanding what the people were trying to do, did not go along with their plans. He disappointed them. He failed to meet their expectations. And this is really the first time of many that we will see in the chapters ahead. Now, I'm sure this was puzzling to the people, puzzling to the disciples, because didn't Jesus want to win the people over to himself? This would have been a great opportunity. You see, there'd been kind of a gathering of momentum leading up to this point. But then Jesus nipped the whole thing in the bud, and he didn't offer any explanation about why. He simply withdrew. Now, of course, we know why. We understand because we know the rest of the story. We know that Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. We know that his kingdom plans go far beyond the Jewish people to include all nations. We know that God's plan of salvation is for all people. And so the disciples, and we as well, Jesus' followers, all have to understand that we need to put our expectations aside so that we can see Jesus for who he is. And when we do that, it is transformational. Now, immediately following this important miracle story is another miracle story, Jesus walking on the water. In the Gospel of Mark, it is reckoned that this took place at 3:00 in the morning. So imagine the disciples are out in the boat. The sea is rough because the winds are high. They see somebody walking towards them in the dark, walking on the water. No wonder they were terrified. But Jesus called out, "It is I, do not be afraid." There is no one else around at this point. So this is a very personal sign for the disciples. It is a personal confirmation to them of who Jesus is and who they are to him. He sought them out. He cared enough about them to go out to them in a miraculous sort of way. So this is really a look at the love that Jesus has for his followers. So what are the takeaway truths for us from these passages this morning? Well, first of all, as we go through the Gospel of John, we're going to come to a fuller understanding of who Jesus is. And we have to remember to keep our ideas and our expectations of Jesus grounded in Scripture. Because it's very easy to start imagining Jesus to be the way we want him to be, or to be the way that our culture wants him to be. So the truth of who Jesus is will be revealed to us as we go through this gospel. He is more than a good teacher. He is more than a wise prophet. What he says of himself is that he is God. The second takeaway truth has to do with what Jesus has called us to do and who we are to him. Now, one of the unexpected things about that miracle story of the feeding of the 5,000 is that Jesus did not do it by himself. Did you notice that the disciples were a part of this miracle feeding as well? Andrew brought the small boy that had the loaves and the fishes. The disciples were gathering up the leftovers in the 12 baskets. And so too, Jesus calls us to be a part of his work in the world. And sometimes God will ask us to be the answers to our own prayers for the needs of the world and the needs of those around us. And also, we bring others to Jesus, as Andrew brought the little boy. And just like the boy, we offer up the little that we have to Jesus and stand by and watch him miraculously multiply it to feed the needs of people. And then the final thing I want to point out from this passage this morning, from the miracle of Jesus walking on the water. Because we all have times in our lives when strong winds are blowing, when the seas are rough, when we are in so much darkness that we cannot only not see where we're going, we can't see where we are. And yet Jesus comes to us in miraculous ways to assure us of his love. So let's come to Jesus this morning and every day with open hearts, open minds, and open hands to receive and experience his unexpected love for us. Amen.
That felt like a really long walk. I feel very compelled to share a story with you guys, and I didn't plan on sharing this. A week ago, I went on an early morning rainy hike by myself, and I was really making a plea before God. And I asked to hear from him because I needed to experience his voice in my life and feel that he still had power over my life. And as I prayed, I experienced him speak to me and think what you want, I don't care. Truly, I know that God spoke to my heart, and it was three words, and the words were, whatever it is. And I immediately felt like I got off track and I lost my sense to hear him. And I thought, oh, I missed the rest. Whatever it is, what? What is it, God? What are you trying to say to me? And I realized instantly that I already have the answer to that. I have the rest of that. What I needed to hear was that God is faithful to me and over my life, whatever it is. So whatever it is, God is still good. Whatever it is, he is still my savior. And that can probably reach you in your places today too, but for me, it was really one of the biggest moments I've ever had with the Lord. And I immediately started just singing like a crazy person on the trail, "Great is thy faithfulness," which is how we're gonna respond today. And I was even using my choir voice, and I thought, man, like, it is just so awesome to worship our God. What a privilege it is that we can just gather today and sing openly with no abandon. Just come before him, because whatever you're going through, God has not forgotten about you. He has not forgotten about his desires that he has placed on your life. And he is big enough to heal the things that you feel are so severed and broken that nothing can be done, but it can. God is really that good and that faithful to us. So can we stand together and just sing out this beautiful song? His compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail. Morning by morning, new.
Thank you, God, for your word of forever, that you are with us. Amen.
As Christians, we are all called to be ministers of Jesus Christ, serving one another and serving in the world. Some of us are called to particular types of service, like pastors and elders and deacons. And today we have the great joy of installing one of our deacons, Ginger Bauer. Would you come forward? Ginger was not here earlier in the year when we did installation and ordination, so we're happy to be doing that for you today. Elder Eric.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of Beulah United Presbyterian Church now installs to the office of deacon, Ginger Bauer.
It is appropriate for us to proclaim our faith as well as Ginger here today. And so I invite you to stand as you are able as we say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Now, Ginger, I want you to answer the constitutional questions. It is of particular significance to me that these questions are the same for pastors, for elders, and for deacons. There's only one question that's specific to the office, but all the other questions, all the officers of the church make their profession of faith. So, Ginger, do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him, Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Do you?
I do.
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be, by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you?
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church, as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Do you and will you?
I do, and I will.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
I will.
Will you be governed by our church's polity? And will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
I will to the best of my ability.
Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
I will.
Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you?
I do.
Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? Will you?
Of course I will.
Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ?
I will.
And these questions are for the congregation. Do we, the members of the church, Accept Ginger as a deacon, chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do we agree to encourage her, to respect her decisions, and to follow as she guides us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church?
And now I want to invite deacons, elders, pastors to come forward as we pray for Ginger with the laying on of hands. Ginger, this is your community of faith. We are your Beulah family, and we gather around you today to promise to pray for you, to work alongside you, to encourage you as you serve Jesus Christ through the ministries of this church and beyond. Let's pray. Loving God, we do pray for Ginger. Lord, you have given her a heart of compassion and mercy, and we ask that you would deepen that and help her, Lord, to find ways to continue to demonstrate that. Please grant to her your wisdom, your words, as she ministers the love of Jesus Christ to those in need, both here in our church and in our community. Lord God, please empower her by your Holy Spirit, that she may use these gifts you have given to her with humility and with compassion. And Lord, above all, we pray that you would give her joy in her work for you. Lord God, together, each one here this morning, may we as your church offer a witness to the world of the love and justice of Jesus Christ. We pray in his name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. This morning, you're going to have some time. You can pray openly, pray aloud. I'll drop a couple different prayer topics, and I'll just give you guys some time to pray. If you feel moved, please just pray aloud. So please pray with me this morning. Now, dear Father, we just thank you, Father, for this morning. We thank you for this place. We thank you for this time. We thank you for prayer time with you. We thank you for the conversation of prayer. We thank you for the gift of knowing that you do listen to us and you do answer our prayers. I thank you, Father, so much for the way you pursue us, the way you do always look for us. You always come to us no matter what is going on in our lives. And as Kelly said, whatever it is, you are faithful. I just love that. Whatever it is, whatever we are, whatever we do, whatever happens, you are always faithful, Father. And I just thank you so much for that comfort in our lives. Currently, Father, we just lift up to you praises, Father. We just lift the praises and any answered prayers. I just do want to lift up mothers on this Mother's Day. And where would we be without mothers? Where would we be without their compassion and their love and their gift to know what to say and what to do at the right time? And I do believe that in mothers, we truly see you. We see that compassion that you have for us and that love for us. So I just thank you for my mother, and I thank you for grandmothers and all the different mothers that are in this congregation this morning. So we lift up praises to you, Father. We pray, Father, for missions. We pray for local missions and foreign missions that we support. Lift up Garfield Farms, who we had the joy of celebrating, some of us last night. We just pray, Father, that you multiply what was raised last night for them so they can buy the rest of the property in their area. Lift up Kay Day, who ministers in Rwanda, and Dr. Macklin in Haiti through his staff at New Hope, or his staff, New Hope Church. And we just continue, Father, that you would just continue to send him your vision that you want for him. Now we pray for France as he continues to finish his home in Haiti, and any other missions that we support, Father, we lift them to you. Father, we pray for our prayer families of the week, Nancy Hornacek and Caitlin Falk, and all of our homebound members and members who cannot make it to church this Sunday, including Dolly McBride. We pray this morning for, Father, anyone struggling with sickness, anyone struggling with any addictions, any issues in their lives, addictions to alcohol, addictions to drugs, pornography, any unhealthy habits, anything that's going on in our lives, Father, we lift them to you now. I want to lift Donna Kunkel and Robin Renka, And I also want to lift babies Sheila Bossy and Sarah Bossy. We just pray for healing, and we pray for your strength to be with them and to surround them, Father. I thank you so much, Father. We thank you for the leadership here at Beulah. We lift the leadership here, Father. We just pray for your spirit to be in them, with them. We pray for compassion in their hearts and forgiveness in them. We pray for the session this coming week as they meet on Tuesday. We lift the session to you, Father, for your decisions. And I want to pray for East End Youth Ministries and the plans that you've been laying on us, Father. We just pray that you continue to bless that ministry moving forward. We pray for your vision to continue to be placed upon Alex. I pray, Father, that you continue to open doors in the Woodland Hills community and put us with the right folks to speak. And I pray for the congregation to rally around that ministry. I also pray, Father, that you help us to think big and long-term, Father. I pray that you fill us with the needs we need, and again, that you help us to think big, large, huge, Father. We just thank you so much for this day. We ask you for your blessings on the balance of this day and on the blessings on everyone in this room, Father. Today we close with the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we'll now collect the morning offering.
Strong. Forever God is with us. For-
send us out now by your Holy Spirit. May our eyes be open so that we can see Jesus walking with us, his presence with us always. And may our ears be open so that we can hear your voice and speak your words. And Lord, may our hearts be open to receive your love, that it may cleanse us and heal us, that we may love this world. So bless us as we go. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Forever God is faithful.